Now, I'll take it briefly to a slideshow in respect of the reform itself, and I'll explain it to you some of the major aspects of the reform. And then the second part of the slide presentation will be done by Jane Curran. And Jane is the director for the Civil Service Reform Management Unit. And she's been with us carrying out the reform. Jane actually comes to us from Australia. Jane first came to Fiji prior to the election, when the Australian government decided to help us with Fijian election office. Those of you who have been in the system for quite some time have noted that previously, just before the election, a lot of civil servants were pulled from different ministries to run the election office, and after elections everybody used to go back. But to get an election office that was fully financially certified accredited, you need to have a full-time staff within the election office. So there is no HR system. That was built up by Jane. She came to us in the Trinity. She did such a fantastic job that she's now helping us in the Civil Service Reform Management Unit. She will actually take you through the actual job evaluation exercise itself and how it worked out, what are the terms and issues that are taken into consideration. And then we have, at the end of the presentation, we have a question and answer session. You can feel free to ask any questions that you may have. Nothing is too silly or too hard to ask. The idea is to do that. If you feel that you want to raise an issue individually without raising in front of everybody else, you also will be given an opportunity, because after the question and answer session, I have for you a very short slide presentation on the budget. Many civil servants don't actually know about the budget and also how your ministry, where you work, actually gets affected, and where you sit in the whole context of that, and we do a very short presentation to you. Is that agenda agreeable to you?
Yes.
Okay. Great. We start off then. Now, a lot of people talk about retirement age. The retirement age in Fiji is independent from 60, and then it continued to be 60 until 1987 when Lautoka carried out the coup, and Lautoka then reduced the retirement age from 60 to 55 in 1987. The retirement age then continued at 55 until 2000, when Garasse came in, and he reduced the retirement, he increased the retirement age from 55 to 60. So 60, Lautoka brought it down to 50, then stayed on 55, sorry, he brought it down to 55, stayed on to 55, and then 2000, Garasse changed it to 60. Now, people speculate as to why did Lautoka reduce it. They say that he wanted to get rid of a whole of civil servants who he did not like, probably because of their ethnicity or whatever the case was. Garasse then increased it to 60 because they say that he may want to have wanted some people to stay within the system, the support of the government. I can tell you why we reduced the retirement age, and that's no speculation. The reason why we reduced the retirement age to 55 is because today, in Fiji, 69.4% of the entire Fijian population is below the age of 40. You see the latest statistics, unemployment in Fiji now has dropped to the lowest it's been in the past 15 years. However, even the overall unemployment rate has dropped to 55, youth unemployment still remains higher than the national average. So our demographics is more like this. People at the top are the people at the higher age. People at the bottom age are more at the bottom. So it's very broad. In Japan, it's a triangle reversed. Very few people, like I said to somebody the other day, recently I went to Yokohama. You have a 75-year-old who's a parking attendant. The security guards were like 17 years old. 80-year-old people are actually working in supermarkets. Because that's how their demographics is. Ours is the other way around. So for us, the reason why we reduced the time and age was that we wanted the younger people to have more access to jobs or more quicker. And of course, what are the new ideas, etc. So that is the reason why we did that. Of course, the retirement age was then challenged by one of the unions in 2008, I think it was, 2007, 2008. And we won the case, both in the High Court and the Court of Appeal, where the court said that we have the ability to actually reduce the retirement age. Of course, those of you who may retire at 55, when you reach the age of 55, one of the directions we've given is that should you be, for example, a school teacher or some other profession within the civil service cadre, should you be leaving, say, for example, in the school in the middle of the term, obviously you'll disrupt classes. So just because your birthday is on September the 30th, which is the middle of the term, you don't retire on September 30th, you retire at the end of the term. So that's the way it's going to be done. Of course, there are some people who skill set is quite scarce, so we may not have enough people of that qualification, I mean that kind of experience. So at one stage, for example, there's shortage of midwives. So should there be shortage of midwives, and they can be re-engaged after the age of 55 until they find, you know, the succession planning is in place and get people to fill in the position. So there are, for example, other professions like engineers or whatever the case may be. The way the system works is that the permanent secretary writes to the Minister of Civil Service, makes out the case, should there be a need that that gets extended. Okay, that's the redundant story. Please tell me if I'm speaking too fast. Objective of the reform. Why are we doing the civil service reforms? It's because we of course want to improve your working conditions. But this is one part of the civil service reform. This first part obviously is that we are not giving you, you are getting a pay raise, everybody, but what we are actually doing is we are actually fixing up the base. As Jane would tell you, we are bringing up your salaries comparative to the market, what exists in the market. You're fixing up the base. And hereafter, you'll be assessed either on an annual basis or 18-monthly basis, on a regular basis in any case. So to be able to assess the individual performances. So you've now fixed up the base. So if we say, for example, that the nurses, specialist nurses, will now start off at, what's the specialist nurse that? BNF starts off at, about $22,000. If you see within that band, you can go all the way up to $36,000. Now, those of you who have been in the service for quite some time, prior to the reform, you would know that if you became, or if you, for example, became senior administrative officer, from junior to senior, when they gave you that position, they would plug you at the bottom end of the scale. Right? They'll plug you there. Very difficult for people to move. Holding the position to move within the band. Very less opportunity. What the performance management system does, it actually gives you the ability to move within the band. A lot more regularly. You don't have to wait for some negotiated outcome or pay rise. This actually gives you a regular basis for you to be assessed. So if you have this wonderful five people sitting in front, and when they get assessed, say, on an annual basis, or eight monthly basis, this lady spend half the time in the roadshow. This lady comes to work on time, performs very high level performer. This lady comes to work at 10 o'clock, starts combing her hair at 4 o'clock, to leave at 4:30. And this person also has performer, and she's an average performer. You should get different increments in your assessment. Because if we give everybody the same pay rise, these two who are not performing well continue to do that because they'll get a pay raise in any case. This lady who's performing really well can be a disincentive for them to do, for her to do well. Might as well, why should I work so hard? These two jokers are not performing well and they get a pay raise. So the performance management system recognizes individuals as to how they perform. Of course, some of the assessment criteria may be based also on the group outcome, but there's also individual assessment. So what we have done now, please understand, what we have done now, and what James talked to you about, is we have looked at the various positions, what responsibilities it holds, and what remuneration it should affect. Thereafter, after the position is filled, then you will get assessed individually. So some of you could get another pay rise very soon, when we have the PMS implemented. And I'll talk to you very quickly about it later on, how you can also appeal, etc. Civil service reform also is about transparent decision making. We have OMRS system. Under the OMRS, people get appointed, they get interviewed based on merit. It's been mentioned to me since 2007, prior to reforms. So many civil servants have said to me, that person got the promotion because he's in Taipei. That person got the promotion because he's in the Fiji. That person got the promotion because the person who hired him, they come from the same province. Or those who were in high school together, or they go to the same church, or they come from the same province, whatever the case was. OMRS, the idea is to get rid of all of that. Now the system is this. If under OMRS, if all of these five wonderful people again apply for the job, and if this lady gets the job because she's got it on merit, the other four people won't find it hard to follow. The other four people won't look behind the back. That's what happens. Many of you would know. A lot of the people believe, oh, that person got the job, they know they did not get it on merit. Then obviously people don't actually have that confidence in their leadership. That person is a winner. The other issue, of course, is that currently in the civil service, prior to the reform, sorry to say, we've been driven by position. We like titles in people. Oh, you know, somebody when I go to a lot of places, he's the administrative officer, senior administrative officer, principal administrative officer, the principal administrative officer, but they all basically work in the same department. Because we're driven by titles. Why are we driven by titles? Because unfortunately for a long time in the civil service, title means higher salary. So you have somebody who may not necessarily apply to say the teaching, nursing and teachers, but you have a lot of people, for example, who may work, say, in Ministry of Industry and Trade. And they become a trade expert. You send them overseas, they go to seminars, they do training, but assuming there is a senior position. But because the system does not allow for pay rises on a regular basis, or assessment on a regular basis, they will, after a period of time, want the pay rise. So they know the way the old system worked was that if this lady's been in the system for a longer period, they'll say she should get the promotion. Not him. Even though he may be a high performer, but because he's been there in less period than this lady here, they'll try and give the promotion to her. He felt it a source of entitlement. Because I've been there 15 years, who are you, some kid who's been there for 7 years? That's the way the system works. Now, the way that the organization of the system works is that previously, so when people, depending on the seniority, not necessarily the performance, but the promotion. So the person gave me my example was industry trade for 10 years. Because he now or she now wants a promotion, so they get a higher salary, they'll look for openings. Oh, Ministry of Mangroves has got a principal administrative officer position. I'll apply for that. So even though he or she may not be interested in mangroves, they know nothing about mangroves. But they'll get the position because this person has been there for 15 years, end up getting a job. What actually happened to us? We've lost all the wealth of experience he or she attained in 10 years as a trade person. We've lost it. We've trained somebody else. It takes probably another 7 years for him to get to know about mangroves. So again, you see, the civil service then does not work efficiently. The idea is that if you like a particular profession within the civil service, you stay there knowing that you can get assessed on a regular basis and get to pay rises. That's the whole idea. The nurses did not have this category of specialized nurses before. It's a new thing. Why have we done that? To recognize, first of all, the fact that they're performing a particular part of the job is something that's specialized. It's different from the others. You have to recognize that, you have to reward that. But it's also incentivizing people to become specialists in different areas. Like I said to a group of lawyers just a few weeks ago, most lawyers and people, if you go around even Lautoka, there's one law firm and one lawyer, at the most maybe two. And they do everything. They do criminal, they do civil, they do law, family matters. Nobody really specializes. We now need specialist lawyers. We're doing so much work for FRA and all these independent contractors, local companies. How many lawyers and people specialize in road construction contracts? None. None. How many of them specialize in, say, medical area of the world? None. They only know about litigation. How many specialize in, you know, in contractual law pertaining to public-private partnerships? None. So this is a problem that exists not just within the civil service, but outside in some of the professions too. We want to bring that level of specialization, and that's part of the reforms too. And also, the reforms does provide the ability to reinforce the constitutional provision of the permanent secretary. As you know under the constitution, your contract, those who have signed contract, your contract is with your PS, with the ministry. Not with the minister, nor is it with the PSC. Before it used to be with the PSC, Public Service Commission. Under the constitution, the Public Service Commission as only authority of the permanent secretaries. They hire the permanent secretaries, they pay the permanent secretaries. We don't. We can't interfere with the PS. So they are the authority for that, and the PS then employs you. So you have the independent relationship. That's why it's what we call creating a more of an independent civil service. Now, the whole idea, of course, is to ensure that you know, we are trained, we attract and retain good people into the service. Now, tomorrow, somebody was to come and set a private hospital in Lautoka, how many of the nurses would leave and go there? Right? But you know, we find, I'll tell you, maybe it is not happening with the nursing culture because it's not in a private hospital. A lot of accountants, a lot of economists, some people who are specialized maybe being the forestry department, etc. What we find is that after a few years in the civil service, they actually leave. They leave for two reasons. One of them is that what we found, and Jane will tell you about this too, when we did a survey and compared what we pay in the private sector and what we pay in the civil service, we found that the intake level, the civil servants at the intake level, were being paid higher than the private sector. As the years went by, they got higher, we got lower. That's what happened. This is why we find a lot of economists, a lot of accountants, they stay within government. 4 or 5 years, get all the experience, the central overseas, etc., they're gone. The World Bank comes along, AMD comes along, others come along, they take them away. Or maybe the Australian government, New Zealand government. So we need to also retain people, because we spend our time and money and energy with them, training them. When it comes for the time for them to actually deliver now, they're gone. So how can we have a efficient and proficient civil service? So this is part of the, you know, the idea is to retain people. If you feel happy with the work environment, you know you're getting regularly assessed, you feel good about yourself. I like my employer. Somebody said to me the other day, why did you know we've increased the bill allowance? It's gone up from $9 to $20. We're looking at other allowances, we another general. Somebody said to me, why did you put it up from $9 to $20? You could have put it up to $11 or $12. Well, $20 maybe, you know, can get you a good meal in Tabua. Maybe a reasonable deal in Lautoka. Maybe it's cut in fine. But certainly won't get you a good deal in Denmark. It's not going to necessarily get you a good deal in Sue, but somebody goes for training or whatever it is, and you get a meal allowance of $9, it's very difficult. You get $20, it's okay. So what we've done with the reform is give us flexibility to be able to bring about changes in many reasons. What I call the day-to-day expenses, day-to-day conditions that you feel good about. You don't have to go and stay at a relative's place and go and, you know, throw their lunch. You can live on your own. That's the point. So, you know, this is part of the reform that we're carrying out. There's a lot more things that we'll be doing. And of course, overall for us, as a government, we really and firmly are committed to the idea of ensuring better services to ordinary Fijians. We have to do that. Remember, your salary, my salary is paid by these people. The cost of increasing the salary and the salaries of all the civil servants is costing us $149 million more. The total salary bill for all the civil servants in Fiji, including if you add the allowances and all of those kind of things over time, is $1 billion, $1.01 billion. This is our total salary bill. Pay for everyone. Before the overtime and all that, it's about $930 million. We add all those additional time, I think it's $1 billion. We don't mind spending it. We don't mind giving the pay rise too. Productivity levels need to increase too. A lot of ordinary people accept me also. I get all sorts of people stopping me in the street, talking to me, giving me phone calls, sending me text messages saying, you give these people a pay rise, how do you know the service level will improve? A lot of people say that. So we say, well, we do the reforms, you know, so we, the good people can come up to the top, etc. So we have to be able to understand that the delivery of service must be very, very significantly improved. As I've said also, and I'm sort of skipping over some of the slides here, I've also said to in the past consultations when we had the teachers, Like, there was a lot of complaints against some of the HR departments in the respective ministry, or the administrators. So we said, for example, to the teacher, we said to the head office of the Ministry of Education, that your clients are the 10,000 teachers. 10,000 teachers, I think. So the Ministry of Education's HR people's objective is, they must satisfy their clients, and their clients are the teachers. The teachers must feel confident in the system. They must know that people have been named head of department, principal, head teacher, whatever it is, on merit. They must know that with the same email, they have a query, you respond to them quickly, give to the doctor. If the teachers are looked after, then guess what the teachers will do? The teachers will also look after their clients. And who are their clients? 220,000 students in Fiji. 220,000 students in Fiji. The teachers, that's their clients. Our clients are everybody. All of you. So this is the way the system must work. Of course, nurses don't necessarily have to answer phone calls, but you can go to certain ministries. There are 3 or 4 people sitting around. The phone is ringing, but nobody wants to pick up the phone. Very basic things. You get so many people telling us, we're standing at the counter, but nobody is serving it. There's even a big color process and no one. So we need to be able to change that culture. That's what we're trying to drive. Next, please. Open merit recruitment system. Essentially, as it's like says, open merit aims to ensure only the knowledge, experience, skills, and abilities required for the job are considered in the system. What we've also said now, that in the panel, so for example, if this gentleman applies for a job, these 3 people at the panel, if it's a job that's below the bank jail, at least 1 person in the panel has to be from outside the ministry. The other 2 are from the ministry. If it's for the position, bank jail and above, one has to be from the ministry, one from outside the ministry, one outside the government. It's a higher position, we need to be able to get different perspectives to ensure there's greater credibility. Some ministries have been very slow in implementing it. That's an administrative issue as opposed to a reform issue. And we've got a lot of complaints about that too. So what we're doing, this allows us the occasion, and Jane and Bernadette are here, we'll talk later on in the video if you want, where you can take your complaints, allows us, these sessions allow us also the opportunity to go to the Ministry of Health or whichever ministry it is, like culture or whatever it is, to say, look, these things aren't working well, your HR department is slow, they need to do the right thing. So, the other point, of course, is that everybody who's on the panel must be trained under the OMR, as they need to understand what it is. There was a particular issue a few months back in the Ministry of Economy when a particular person's appointment was sent up to me. We discovered that one of the persons who sat on the panel had not been trained under the OMRs. So we sent it back. They had to redo the entire interview and get somebody that should be trained. But please get the person to be trained first. I suggest to all of you, please get some training because you may be asked to sit on the panel. It's a good thing. It's a good experience. And the Civil Service Reform Management Unit runs various training sessions. So if a group of nurses in Lautoka, when they have training, you can request it, email us, they'll come down and train you. So you get your chance. When somebody next time somebody applies for a job, the HR department should know, so they don't have to send somebody from Suba. Okay, so that's part of it. The other process, of course, is that when you apply for a job in the OMRS, so assuming all of these people apply, maybe I'll leave them alone, but these ladies here, if all these 4 ladies apply for a particular position, and this lady who wants to go to the private hospital, she applies for the position, but she feels the process was not fair. She wants to appeal. She has the right of appeal. All of you have a right of appeal. Now, when you appeal, she does not have to tell her immediate boss. She does not have to tell the PS. She does not have to tell the minister. She writes directly to the PSC. Right? Now, the PSC has now got a full-time commissioner who hears appeals. His name is Laurie McGrath. He's actually an Australian with a widespread experience of the PSC on the commission. He's already had appeals. He's upheld 5 appeals. 4 or 5 appeals. 4. He's upheld 4 appeals. The system is working. Why does she apply to TSC? Because I've just told you that TSC has got nothing to do with employment. The reason why she applies to TSC is because your permanent secretary is responsible for this process. Whether it's a driver's position or director of nursing position or deputy PA, that's his responsibility. If the system is not working, it's a fault of his or he should fix up the process. So when she applies to the TSC commissioner, it's paper-based. You don't have to turn up and go away from the Lautoka, simply write in. He then will investigate. If he then finds that the process indeed was not run properly, he then gives a direction to the permanent secretary, in this case, permanent secretary of health, if you have a nurse coming, to say, review the entire thing. Because the commission has the ability to direct the PAs, not us. There will be political interference. The PSC has the ability to direct the PAs to make sure the process takes place again. At no stage would the PS know that this is this late service, you know? That Wendy was the one who applied for the appeal. Nobody would know. So that's how the system works. So you've got the appeal process there. Okay? Next. Oh, here we go. So, there you go. So I've done all of that. Oh, sorry. Last point. When Wendy applied, and the commissioner says, yes, the process was not fair, the commissioner has got no powers to take the PS, appoint her, or appoint her. What the commission can say, the commissioner can say, is the process was not fair, review the whole thing. Okay? Thank you. Okay, contracts. Contracts by law can be up to 5 years. As we've said, for the nurses and the teachers, you'll get contracts up to 5 years. Because of the high volume and the kind of work that you do. Now, the current contract officers for the balance of the current term, as you know, prior to the reform, already 70% of all civil servants were on contract in any case. It's only the 30% that work. Now, if you're given a contract, you have not been on contract, you're given a contract, it's your choice. You don't want to sign the contract, that's fine. You don't have to sign the contract. You're not going to get the pay raise. It's very simple. The contract actually stipulates the pay rate, your new pay. So you can continue with that. Of course, after a period of time, it may well be found that your position needs to change also because the salary needs to be commensurate to the level of responsibility you have. Okay? Now, there's a lot of misinformation that I know some trade unionists were saying that a lot of people speculated. They were saying that if you get a contract, you no longer can get a job with, you no longer can get a loan from a bank. Up and nonsense. Banks give you loans, even if you have a contract. The banks have come out publicly and said that they'll give you loans. If you go and talk to somebody in the private sector today, who've been working there with some of the organizations, they're all on contracts. Nobody's in a position, they all get loans. Prior to this job of mine, I was in the private sector too, I had a 3-year employment contract. And I had 2 of them. Banks can give you loans. It's not an issue at all. The other issue, of course, is that just because you've got a contract, it does not mean that your contract can be terminated at any time. The contract is governed by what is written in the contract. Your terms of employment is also governed by the discipline guidelines that is rolled out. It's all available on the website. Please go to the website. Jane will give you all the addresses. It's all there. So just because, say, this lady is the permanent secretary, she wakes up in the morning and does not like the color of spectacles, she can't fire him. She can't fire him for any reason unless she follows the guidelines. She can't even suspend him unless she follows the guidelines. The discipline guidelines are very clearly stipulated. Part of the process, too, if she believes there needs to be some kind of termination or suspension in place, the rules of natural justice must be followed. She cannot simply do that. She actually has to say to him, this is the allegation. He has to be given the opportunity to respond. Should there be a decision made subsequently, he has to be given a reason as to how the decision was arrived at and what that decision actually means for him. And even after that, even if he is not pleased with it, he can also appeal it. And even after appeal is not satisfied, he can go to the Employment Relations Tribunal. You need to go to employment relations tribunal, he's not happy with it. Or you can go to the public service discipline tribunal, you say the PSDT. Even after that, there's also ways of dealing with your legal issues. You've got a lot of ground to keep. Of course, the contract confirms the fundamental shift in remuneration, not just a single pay rise. The level of responsibility, etc., is all there. So as I said, it's no offer, no pressure, it's an offer, sorry, no pressure to accept. You may deny it if you want, your choice. There was a question that was asked in some suburb of Jane yesterday. The lady said, if she was a nurse, can I sign a contract after I come back from my annual leave or long service leave? Yes, you can. Yes, you can. Next, please. Okay, the other thing about in the reform is the discipline. In the discipline, we believe that there needs to be what we call also positive discipline. The example that I have used is this. Some teachers in Fiji, many teachers in Fiji actually double up the student counselors. The reason why they double up the student counselors is because there's no professional student counselors in Fiji. Very few, maybe one or two. None of you, I don't know how many of you are parents and have got children in university, about to go to university. How many of you have actually said to children, son or daughter, we want you to become a professional counselor? Many parents would tell the children we want you to become a doctor, nurse, lawyer, engineer, you know, those traditional ones. Nobody says we want you to become a counselor. Nor do we encourage people to become counselors. As a result of that, many teachers unfortunately double up as counselors. We get complaints. So assuming this lady is a student, is a teacher, she doubles up as a student counselor. Now, then, assuming that there's a complaint made against her, she may have done something that she should not have done as a counselor. Maybe the student complains and the parent complains. And then there's an investigation. They do find out that she did do the wrong thing. But if they do find out she did the wrong thing, maybe the reason why she did the wrong thing was because she's got no training in that area. Now, if she's got no training in that area, then really it's not her fault. The employer has put her in a position where she's actually making a decision in an area where she's got no training. So the positive discipline outcome would be, they'll say to her, we'll send you for training for 3 months, so you can become proficient in that area. That's what you call a positive discipline. Some of your nurses sometimes may be doing things on a continuous basis, but you're not trained. So maybe it's not obviously your fault, could be because of whoever is your supervisor put you in a position where you had to do something, and obviously if you don't have the experience, you may have done something incorrect. You should not be punished for that. You should be given more exposure to be able to get trained for next time, you should do better or correct. Of course, like I mentioned, principle of natural justice must be always followed, investigation, decision making. We want to improve, of course, training. A lot of the training for the civil service we rolled out through the Ministry of Civil Service itself. Sessions we're running in different divisions, and of course, one of the issues that we found, although this is about discipline, is that generally we find most ministries and the HR departments aren't very good at communicating information. A lot of the things that a lot of you face and I've seen throughout all the consultations, that's one thing that's come out very strongly. Everybody complains about the lack of information. It's the responsibility of the individual ministry to do that. A lot of times people are kept in the dark. Sometimes you find that decisions have been made unilaterally by some people without actually following the general orders, without necessarily being a policy of government itself, but people can make up their own rules. That's one of the areas we have to fix up. And one of the issues, for example, was raised by regarding the issue of health. Jane and Bernadette had a meeting with your permanent secretary and the director of HR on Thursday last week. And they managed to iron out a lot of the issues. We find a lot more communication problem too. Not better through that. Okay. Performance assessment. This is what I have mentioned to you about how we're developing the guidelines for your individual performance. It's a massive job, because obviously we have to have performance assessment criteria for the different positions. We have over here from this room, people from health, from agriculture, maritime, whatever ministry there is. And even within those ministries, we have different levels of responsibility. different positions. So we have to develop all of them, then people can be assessed. So those guidelines should be rolled out by the end of this year. It will be, of course, objective, independent assessment, criteria, which should be known in advance. You should know beforehand on what basis will you be assessed. So when the assessment comes, at least you know what you've been working towards. You don't want to just pull it out of a hat. You need to know beforehand. So a lot of this is to do about information sharing. This is one of the things we found out, that there is a culture within the government, in the civil service, within the respective ministries. Some ministries are better than others, but some ministries are not very good at information sharing. You hear from third parties, fourth parties, second parties, tenth parties. Then of course you have rumor mongering that takes place. Somebody said, I heard this, and somebody makes a post on Facebook, and everybody follows along the line. A lot of people believe whatever comes on Facebook must be the gospel truth. Obviously it's not. So this is what we're saying. The individual ministries have to improve their communication with all of you. I'm sure all of you civil servants have access to email, at least to workplace. It should be very easy to disseminate the information. You, of course, once you get assessed, like I know the Solicitor General's office, they've already started implementing this performance assessment. Over there, one of the criteria they have is that if I'm sort of being assessed, say, if I'm, say, principal legal officer, when I get assessed by my juniors, I also get assessed by my seniors. Because we need to know how they perform with the people there, leaders too. And of course, you have a right of appeal. The panel that assesses you says, okay, your performance has been 110%. And you have to appeal it and say, no, actually, I think I was 150%, you can appeal it. You may get a score of 20%, you can appeal that also. You think it should be higher. I don't think anybody will appeal and say it should be lower, unless they're very, very honest. Of course, the results will confirm movement up the steps in the salary bands, pay increases in the budget cycle. That's what we said. That's what the performance assessment does. So there are people who, your rebasing has been done this year. If you get your assessment done next year, you get the opportunity to get another rise next year. Effective into the budget. Okay. Now, the other thing I want to take you before I pass over to Jane is, if you've got the sheet with you, now you've got, all of you have got a pay rise. Okay? But in fact, you've had two bites of the cherry. The way you've had two bites of the cherry is because there's announced in the budget the income tax threshold has now increased from 16,000 to 30,000. In other words, what that means simply, you no longer pay any single cent of tax until you earn more than 30,000 for the year. Okay? Don't pay any tax. But a lot of people don't realize this. Those people who earn over $30,000, they also have had a tax cut. Because the way the taxation system works is that when the income tax threshold is increased, everybody above that also has to get a tax cut. Of course, it's not as significantly as those people below 30,000, because you cannot have somebody not paying tax of $30,000 and a person then who earns $30,001 should not have to pay 15%. Because then their pay will actually take home pay and become far less than the person who is earning $29,000. The way the system works is that they've also got a tax cut. Let me show you how it works. So let's take a nurse, say who's a nurse team leader, band G, who earns currently $24,000. Income tax threshold at 16,000, you pay tax of $909.78. Your take home pay is $23,811. But now, a nurse team leader, band G, after the reform, job evaluation, I should say, her salary has gone up from $24,000 to $28,000. Okay? Now, if the income tax threshold was at 16, you would pay a tax of $1,608. So the take-home pay would be $26,906. An increase of $3,100 compared to this one here. In actual terms, that's how much you take home in your pocket extra. Now, because the threshold has increased to $30,000, this person has jumped from 19, used to pay $219 tax, used to pay $900 tax, would have to pay $1,600. Now, because they no longer pay any tax, they've had a pay rise of $4,700. see that? See the difference? Because you pay zero tax, your salary is increased from 24,000, gone up to 28,000. No longer paying in tax, you have an increment of $4,700, as opposed to if the income tax threshold had not increased, you'd have got a pay rise of only $3,100. So you're essentially getting another $1,600 more in your pocket because of the income tax threshold going up to $30,000. So that's how much more money you get in your pocket if you had that bad. Now let's take somebody who used to earn more than $30,000. So senior surveyor, for example, before the job regulations, getting $31,000, pays a tax of $2,000, take home pay $29,000. Now they had about a 37% pay rise, the senior surveyors. They jumped from $31,000 to $43,000 pay rise. If the income tax threshold was $16,000, they would pay $4,200 tax, take home pay $39,000. Increase of $9,000 more in their pocket, $9,800. But now, instead of paying $4,200 tax, that person will pay only $2,300 tax. You see that? So instead of paying $4,200, they pay $2,300. So instead of getting a $9,800 increase, they're getting $11,700 increase because their tax has also come down. Everybody's got a tax. I mean, I can see how much the jump you've had. For example, you have a chief engineer, or let's see, director of nursing. Currently the salary is $44,000, they go up to $67,000. And because they've also got a tax cut, instead of paying $9,000 tax, they pay $7,100 tax, so the increase in their take-home pay is $20,700. That's how significant these pay rises actually are. You take into account the tax cut. That's where I am shocked. And Jane will now explain to you about the job evaluation exercise. And then we'll come back for question and answer.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. So my part of the session is the more technical HR side. So most of you, I'm assuming, are not HR specialists. You have your own specialist field. So it's to give you a little bit of information about how this works from the HR perspective and how it comes back together. Because we know it's a lot of changes in the way we manage your employment, your terms and conditions. So first of all of the changes in the reforms come through guidelines that are approved by the Public Service Commission in their role as the supervisor for the Permanent Secretary. So the guideline for job evaluation was approved in January this year, and it's available on the Public Service Commission website. It's been there since January this year. The transition procedures, so the procedures around the contracting and the increase in salary and how that would all operate, they're also on the Public Service Commission website. They've been there since March this year. It is a fundamental change to the way we organise the pay. In the past, there were a number of occupational scales, so the NU, the AC, the ED, all of those occupational scales. So now, and qualifications sometimes awarded people with an automatic increase. Now it's about the position and the person being considered separately. So we evaluate the position based on the duties of the job and the responsibility requirements. And then we separately evaluate your performance to determine where or what step you sit on the band. So the jobs get evaluated first and get placed on the bands, and that's what determines the range of salary for the particular position. The qualification requirements are only one of 10 factors that are considered when we evaluate the job. When we do job evaluation, and I can see at least one trained evaluator in the room, that we make a couple of assumptions because we are looking at the job. We assume that the people doing the job, once you're appointed to the job, that you know what you're doing and that you will be competent. So we don't evaluate a job based on what might happen if somebody gets it wrong. We assume that the people will get it right. We also assume that there's that the workforce management is right, that there's enough people to undertake the duties that are required. And we know in some instances that that isn't the case, that some ministries are understaffed. That can't be fixed through job evaluation. That needs to be fixed by the ministry looking at the structure and assigning the correct number of jobs to undertake those particular duties. So before I go into the more technical parts of the job evaluation, I just wanted to recap on how the different guidelines come together, because the Minister has mentioned the other guidelines that have already been approved, and they build up to a whole picture of how we manage employment in the civil service. So the first one is job evaluation. So job evaluation looks at the position and determines the band that the position goes on to. Open merit is how you compete for the job. It's how you get appointed to that particular job. So you have a look and say, that's the job I want. Everyone now wants to be director of nursing in a hospital because it's jumped up to a lovely salary. So you decide, I want that one, and you apply for it through open merit. Discipline is about how we work with you to improve performance or to address code of conduct issues, to make sure that everyone is behaving in the workplace and working the way we expect them to work. And lastly, performance management is about how we assess your performance to move you on to higher steps within the band that's been allocated for your position. So each guideline has its own part to play in the cycle of your employment. As with all of the guidelines, there have been a few issues in implementation. These have been covered through various sessions. The job evaluation, the results reflect the quality of the information that was supplied through the various ministries. So a lot of you would have been involved in writing up job descriptions, and they were used by the job evaluation committees to evaluate the jobs. Some of those job descriptions didn't fully reflect what you actually do in your jobs. Some of them, even the reporting relationships weren't right. We would try and look at a set of jobs to identify and make sure that a subordinate position was on a lower band to a superior position. But some of the jobs, we couldn't even work that out from the job descriptions that were submitted. So in some instances, there have had to be reviews, and we've received submissions, and we're quite happy to review those jobs with the additional information that's supplied. I think everyone's got a better picture now of how important that documentation actually is in this process. All the tranches are now complete. There were three tranches, so the first tranche came out in July. That was the administrative cadres. Then the second tranche came out in August, and that was the nurses and the teachers particularly, and the social workers. And the third tranche came out last week. So the third tranche is the technical and other engineering, legal officers, those types of jobs were in tranche three. The reports went to the permanent secretaries Monday last week. The payroll has generated the reports, and we're currently checking those so that the contracts can be issued. So they've started to go out to ministries. Everyone should have their contracts by the end of this week, their offer by the end of this week. With the contracts, the lists are generated from the payroll. So when we look at what step to put you onto, it's based on the step that you were on before, and that's generated from payroll. If anyone is missing, so if anyone hasn't received their contract, we need to investigate with payroll what happened, because if you're on the payroll, then you should be on a list. But sometimes things go missing. We're dealing with a large volume of people. If we know about it, we can check it and look into it for you. The contracts are for your substantive position, so the position that you're actually appointed to. If you're acting on a position, then you'll get a contract for your old substantive position and an acting letter for the higher rate on the position that you're acting on. Sometimes the acting letters in those circumstances come a bit later because the ministry focuses on the substantive post first, and then they issue the acting letter. The transitional step for nurses, so in tranche three there are some positions as well. Because people are allocated to the step on the band that's within 15%. For a lot of nurses, depending on the step that you're on in the old salary scales, step one was above 15%. So we've allocated to the transitional step so that we don't have to advertise the positions and you don't have to apply for the positions. But in January, when the performance management guideline comes out, there will be an interim performance assessment to confirm that you're performing the range of duties required for the role, and then you'll immediately go on to step one, and then there'll be another performance assessment later on, March, April, in order to put you onto higher steps in the new budget cycle. So the transitional step is temporary. It's not intended that anyone will stay there for a long time. It was a way of making the appointments without having to advertise all of the positions. So there has been some inaccurate information circulating around. There have been no salary decreases. We check the payroll reports before we send them out to the ministries. The payroll report includes a column that shows us the percentage increase. The only time that there would possibly be a decrease is perhaps if you're acting and they've taken you back to your substantive post, so it looks like there's a decrease, but there's no decrease on that actual substantive post. If you think there's an error that's been made, you need to report it to your HR, because we can check that and we can fix that. Most of the calculations are done automatically through the payroll, so they should be right, but in some instances there have been manual calculations and it's possible that something's been missed. It is possible, like I said, to have a review of the band that the position is on, and some groups of positions have asked for reviews and we are working through those. So the medical imaging technologists, the physiotherapists, the dietitians, so we're working through the reviews that have come in and we'll get through them as fast as we can. There isn't a deadline, but the contract starts from the beginning of the month, or the first pay in the month, that you sign your contract. So the start date is the first pay, so if it was August, it's the 30th of August. If it's September, it's the 10th of September. If it's October, it's the 8th of October. The exception to that is if it's not your fault that you didn't sign the contract. So if the contract wasn't issued to you, so if you were missing off the list and you weren't able to sign the contract, then we would backdate it to the effective month for the tranche that you were supposed to sign the contract in. But if you're asking for a review of the position and you don't want to sign the contract until the review is completed, then that is effective in the month that the contract is issued. So I mentioned before, there is a threshold for the increases in salary for them to be automatic. The threshold is 15%. So everyone went to the step on the band that gave a maximum of up to 15%. If there is no step, so if the increase is greater than 15%, the positions have to be advertised. With such large increases in salary, it's important that we make sure that the right people are appointed to the jobs through open merit so that there's a competition process and we make sure that everyone is properly appointed to those high level jobs. Ministries are putting acting arrangements in place. So particularly in health and education, the acting arrangements were supposed to be automatic until the open merit is completed, and that is to make sure that there's no disruption to service delivery. Through these consultations, we have found out that some of that acting hasn't been issued yet, and we're working with the ministry to resolve that. And again, because it's no fault of yours, we'll make sure that it gets backdated to August, which is when those health positions came out. In other positions, so positions like in the admin cadres, under open merit, there needs to be an expression of interest for the acting, so that we fairly make sure that the person is appointed to act in the post. But the contract that's been issued guarantees that you have a position at that level. So there's no job losses, there's no threat to your employment through the job evaluation process. Ministries where there's a large volume of positions to be advertised, particularly health and education, have been asked to prepare a recruitment plan because they're not going to advertise all of the positions all at once. They will generally start at the top. They've been asked to prepare a recruitment plan and publish that so that you know, for example, director nursing in a hospital is going to be advertised in X month and it's going to close here and appointments should be made down the track. So they're supposed to plan that out and actually publish it so that you can see and prepare yourself for those advertisements. Get yourself ready to be able to put in your application and compete through the selection process. We've given ministries a deadline of having their recruitment plans published by next month. And we mean early next month, not the end of next month. So I mentioned job evaluation is based on a number of factors. Education is one of them. So we use a commercial methodology. There are a number of them out there. The one that won the tender for government is called SP10. Strategic Pay is the SP. They're a company based in New Zealand. And the 10 is that there are 10 factors that we consider when we evaluate a job. The first one is education. It is the education that is required for the position, not the education that is held by the person who might be sitting in the post. Because we're looking at the position, we don't know who's sitting in the post. If a person holds a qualification that's higher than what is required for the position, that is considered through performance management, performance assessment. It has no bearing on the band of the position. So if you hold a master's and the position requires a degree, we would expect in the performance assessment that you will demonstrate a higher level of proficiency than someone who has the lower qualification. But it's not automatic based on the fact that you have the qualification. You have to demonstrate that in the performance assessment. The next one is experience. Again, it's the experience that's required for the job, not the experience that's necessarily held by someone who is sitting in the job. So it's how long would it take for someone to become competent in a particular role. That's what we mean by experience in this particular exercise. So in some roles, like a receptionist, it might be 6 months. It might take you that long to learn where everybody is in your organisation, how to direct the phone calls in the right place, how to deal with people and answer simple queries. But in other jobs, of course, it can take many years to become fully competent. And those years can include the time that it takes to train you. So that's about the experience. It's not just, oh, well, you graduate and you need 1 year. Well, actually, if it took you 3 years to do a vocationally based training course and then 1 year after that, then it's 4 years that's required in the job. So that's the experience factor. Complexity is the level of predictability in the job. When you come to work each day, do you know exactly what you're going to do? Are you processing, say, checks and vouchers and doing some accounting tasks? Or are you doing something where you know that what the end product is, but how you get there might change every single day? So obviously, the more predictable the job, the lower the score, because the easier it is to know exactly what you have to do. Scope is about the breadth of control, how much control you have over staff and resources. In order to achieve the work, do you have control over moving resources around so that you can better complete the task, or does someone else do that? Someone who's in charge of you, are they in control of the resources that you need? The next one is problem solving. What types of problems do you encounter during your day? How available are rules and guidelines? So these, you should be able to see how these start to link together. The higher the education, the higher the problem solving that we would expect. And the methodology itself tells us when those factors don't match, so that we go back and check the sorts of scores that we are allocated. So problem solving, is it a problem where I can go to a rule book and find the answer and deal with it, or is it something where I have to apply more judgment in order to resolve whatever the issue is? Freedom to act is directly linked to problem solving. to freedom to act, once I look at the types of problems that I have, freedom to act is there someone else there to help me to solve those problems? So problem solving, are there rules? Freedom to act, is there someone else who can help me? Do I have an immediate supervisor who can help me solve my problems, or do I really have to do it all myself? The impact of my decisions, it's not about what happens when something goes wrong. We don't evaluate a job based on what happens if I get this wrong. We evaluate it based on competence. So the effect of the organisation on the decisions that you make. Can you affect the reputation of the organisation? Can you make money for the organisation? Can you improve things in the organisation? Interpersonal skills is about who you talk to and for what reason. Are they people inside the organisation or outside the organisation? Do you deal with clients, external customers? And what do you do with them? Do you explain things to them? Do you negotiate with them? Do you try and persuade them to do something differently? So they're the different types of interpersonal skills. Authorities is the authority of the position to spend money and to hire or fire staff. Well, most of us can't spend money because there's not much delegation under the Permanent Secretary, but a lot of us have a budget even though we can't do the final authorisation to spend. So there's different levels in terms of authorities, and people management is about how many staff you supervise. So how many people directly report to you, but then also how many people report to them. So it's not just the direct reports to you, it's the total number of staff that you're responsible for as the supervisor. So the further you go up, of course, the higher that number will be, and it gets a score accordingly. Those 10 factors add up to a final score that puts the position on the band. When the job evaluators were doing the evaluations, they didn't know what the salary bands would look like. They knew that we were going to have salary bands because that was the result that was coming out in the evaluations. But the money attached to the salary bands was done as a separate exercise. If you think of it as two sides of the coin, so the job evaluation itself is one side, the salary bands are the other side. So the salary bands were developed using research from the World Bank and also input from Strategic Pay as our partner with the job evaluation. There are 15 broad bands. You have a copy. It's the single double-sided sheet that has the salary bands on one side and a little bit of information on the other. These are available on the Ministry of Economy website. If you need other copies for whatever reason, they will publish the day after the budget came out. So all positions now fit onto these bands, including the GWEs. So we've got the GWEs, there's no more of those occupational bands, though every position fits onto these 15 broad bands. The salary bands are benchmarked to the private sector, so we talk about paying market rates, but how did we decide what a market rate was? Because private sector, not everyone pays the same, and in fact they don't publish their salaries. So it is the midpoint in the salary bands that is benchmarked to the private sector, so step four in the salary bands, and that's why it's in bold. It's a very important point in terms of the way the salary bands are constructed. When we started doing the research, we first did a benchmark compensation survey. The World Bank came in, working with us, selected a sample of positions. They went out to the private sector and they said, how much do you pay for these types of positions? So we have a report that tells us, for example, what an accountant might get paid with a particular type of duty, or what an economist might get paid in the private sector. From that report, we said, well, there's no private sector for teachers and nurses. So we asked the World Bank to do another study. So the second study that we got from the World Bank was we asked them to go out to the countries in the region and to look at not what teachers and nurses get paid in those countries, but what occupations they align to. So do they get paid similarly to accountants? Or, and it was actually accountants and statisticians and economists that they're grouped with in most countries. So that was another piece of research that we had for benchmarking to the private sector. And then when we partnered with Strategic Pay, they partner with PricewaterhouseCoopers, who are based here in Fiji, and they do the annual salary survey. So they have data for Fiji that says in the private and the public sector, on an annual basis, if you're at the equivalent of our band H, this is what they pay in the private sector. And they release a report each year that you have to pay for, it, of course, because it's a private accounting firm. But it says, at this level, this is what the private sector pays. Now, they pay a range, of course. It's not an exact dollar figure. So they pay a range, and our midpoints are constructed around that range. As the Minister mentioned, the first thing we discovered from that research is at the bottom, so it bands A, B and C particularly, we already paid more than the private sector. So our midpoint at those bands is still more than the private sector. It's around 110% still of the private sector. But as we go up through the scale, we were looking at, well, what should we be benchmarking to? The World Bank's recommendation was 75% of the private sector, because there are other reasons why people work in the public sector. It's not just around salary. So we have a sliding scale. At the bottom, 110%, at the top, about 60%, and in the middle, about 100%, coming to average across all of the bands of 94% of the private sector. So depending on the job that you're in, would depend on how competitive we are to the private sector. But again, there are other reasons that people work or choose to work in the public sector. The bands, like I said, are available on the Ministry of Economy website. And the Job Evaluation Committees didn't know the dollars, so it was quite an independent process. It wasn't about saying, oh, we want this position to get this much money. It was an independent evaluation to put them onto the bands that then had the money assigned to them. I've mentioned before the step in transition, so what's the jobs went into the band? The step that you went to is solely based on 15%, a maximum of 15%. From your previous step. So people have said, well, I was expecting more, why can't I go to the next step? If you do your own calculations, you would find that the next step would be above 15%. If it's not, contact us and we'll look into it. For new appointments, the other point to note with the salary bands is that they're not designed for people to start on step one. So some of the information that's going around is, oh, but if you look at them, it's not really a salary increase, because people who used to be an SSO3, the starting salary is now lower than what it was before. Yes, it is, but that's because it's not designed for everyone to start on step one. The salary bands overlap. So for new people coming into a job, whether it's new to the service or people who are being promoted, they go to the step on the band determined by the selection process. So if you have a really high result in the selection process, say 90%, you would go to step three. If you have a somewhat lower result, so maybe you only just are determined to be suitable, maybe 50 or 60%, you're on step one. Step four is what we call the competent step. So anyone who's performing the full range of the duties of the job, and that will be assessed through the performance assessment, we'll move, we expect, to step four. So that's why when new people come in, it's based on how much learning we expect they will have to do in the job. So if you're on probation, you're still learning parts of the job, then you're on steps one, two, or three. If you're a high flyer, so you're doing much more than the requirements of the job, then that's steps five to seven. But step four is where most people will end up through the performance assessment. I mentioned I've lost count of how many times. Positions above 15% have to be advertised. This is, of course, to make sure that we have the best person in those jobs, where we've put such high increases into those jobs. The snapshot identifies these positions. So the snapshot is the three-page document that you have. These aren't on slides because they don't fit. So it looks like this, it's three pages, double-sided, the first page and then the third page. In the snapshot, it doesn't show every position. It shows a sample of positions because every position is a book about Nathan. So we're not going to kill that many trees and bring it out. Your ministries have the full list, and this is what comes out in the payroll report. So in the snapshot, it identifies the positions and the percentage increase for those positions. So you'll see that in the columns. Anywhere where the position is indicated as having an increase of more than 15%, there'll be another entry on the left-hand side that shows the level that the position would then be contracted at, and that's where your substantive position would be if you're not appointed through the open merit process. So these are the positions where you'll get the contract at the lower band and then the acting at the higher band until the positions are advertised and the appointments are finalised. And if you don't, if you either don't apply for the position or you don't win the position at the higher band, then you know the band that you're going back to, the band that you'll be placed on if you don't get the position through the open merit. In health and education, like I said, the acting was supposed to be automatic and we're following that up with the ministry. I think education is basically sorted out now and health is working on it. Other things that are happening, so that's the end of the job evaluation. Okay, so that's everything to do with the job evaluation. We wanted to highlight for you that there are a range of activities apart from the guidelines that are happening at the ministry level. So the reforms are not just about the guidelines, there are also activities happening in the ministries. All ministries are required to look at their business processes. So if you think back where the minister first started, we said that the overall outcome for the reforms is improved service delivery for the public. Part of that is giving you good terms and conditions and better working conditions, but of course we need to improve the way we actually deliver our services to the public. So part of the reforms is to actually do business process improvement, and we are working with all ministries not to review their processes for them, but to teach them how to do it for themselves. The World Bank has been coming around and doing institutional reviews in all ministries. These reports are all with the Permanent Secretary and the relevant minister. The only ministries that aren't complete yet are education and industry and trade. Everyone else has their report. Some ministries are seeking some more support to implement the recommendations from those reviews. And your own senior management needs to communicate what will happen at your ministry level. It's not really possible in a session like this to go through that in detail with you. So we're going back to the ministries and saying you need to communicate and tell people what's happening at their own ministry level. As a bit of an idea, in education, they're approaching their ministry structure quite differently to the other ministries. They have two studies about to start. One is a review of the headquarters and the education offices, and the other one is a staffing ratio study to look at class sizes and the school-based aspects of education. In health, the World Bank did complete the review of the Ministry of Health. They've had the report for a little while. They've done a first level review of headquarters and their management structures, and they're about to start a review of the medical superintendent and the hospital manager roles. So they've been working on the terms of reference for that. And they're also, the Ministry of Health is our pilot for the human resource management information system for the whole of government. Because part of the issues that they have in managing your terms and conditions and getting it right is that they do it in spreadsheets. And in a ministry as big as health, that makes it really difficult. So we need better use of technology to help in order to be able to better support you out in the field. So health is the pilot ministry for that activity, and that's due to start probably November. If you're interested, we encourage you to try and seek out more information. These information sessions have been running for some time, not with the Minister, obviously, limited time, but we also have information officers in the Reform Management Unit. They come out regularly. I think Bernie came out a little while ago and did a session. She said she recognised some of the people here from the session that she did last time she was over in the West. We're happy to come and do sessions with individual work units or in hospitals or in other areas, wherever, because they're a bit more mobile than what our core team is. They're available, you just need to contact us and we'll coordinate it at a local level to keep you updated on what's happening with the reforms. We also run a lot of training. Now, we partner with the Ministry of Civil Service. We don't belong to the Ministry of Civil Service. We sit in the Ministry of Economy, but we partner with the Ministry of Civil Service. The Ministry of Civil Service runs the training after the guidelines have been through the initial implementation phase. So they take the ongoing training. And one of the activities that they're running at the moment that should be of interest to a lot of people is CV writing and interview skills. So if you are going to be in a position where you have to apply for a higher position or where you want to apply for one of these positions when they're advertised, we would encourage you to get in touch with the training unit in the Ministry of Civil Service and look at when those sessions will be run over here in the West. If you have any difficulty finding the information, email us on the inquiries email and we will forward it to the right place for you. We run the discipline training, so the Civil Service Reform Management Unit, because discipline is still in the implementation phase. We run training for all supervisors and managers. Again, if you're going to be applying for a job, it's in your own interest to actually attend that training. A lot of it is actually about good supervision and management, which will be very useful for you if you're applying for supervisor roles when these jobs are advertised. We also run investigation officer training, which is another good activity to do if you're looking at moving into higher level positions. There'll be other training coming up, obviously, on the performance assessment when it's rolled out. So we will bring out more information once that guideline is ready. So the main message here is to use the inquiries email. Keep in touch if you have any queries. We can't answer everything, but we can certainly try and improve the communication with your individual ministries in order to be able to get you the answers that you need.
Thank you, Jim. Please make a note of this email, that email address. We're getting a lot of people emailing in Europe. In fact, I've been getting a few things yesterday. And as James said, I think James said that email, if you send me that email address, not everybody gets to see it. So it's just one or two of us. So it's very confidential in that respect. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, let me open up the floor now. We've got somebody going around with the mic. Please feel free to ask any questions. And like I said, if you wish to discuss anything that you may not want to discuss in front of the others, you can do so personally, because after the question and answer session, we'll have the budget presentation. And during the session, those of you who have questions can do that. In fact, yesterday in Lambasa, we found there was hardly any questions, but people sort of went individually during the budget session to talk about them individual issues. You can do that. But like I said, if you do not want to discuss it today, you can also email on that email address and then people can come back to you very quickly. Okay?